Good morning. Yes, it's still here. I keep praying, though, that God would give me strength. And for 3 weeks, I've been asking that he take away my sore throat. And I trust him that he's going to. It's not a sore throat because it doesn't hurt at all. But so far, it's still here. And to God be the glory. I trust him for that. I was sitting there praying, asking the Lord, hey, this would be a great time for this to be gone. So if in the middle of the, while I'm talking, it disappears, you know to give credit to. Well, anytime it disappears, you know who to give it credit to. So hopefully it'll go away. But I brought water along. Cassidy's home, and we had the Monday Thursday service here Thursday night, and yesterday or Friday or Saturday we were sitting around the table talking about the service and different things going on. I was like, yeah, one of the difficult things with my voice being like this is when I try to project, when I get excited, it goes up high, but if I talk down low, it's better. So when I try to sing, it doesn't work so well. And she started laughing. She's like, yeah, I heard you trying to sing Thursday night. Yeah, good to have you home. She leaves tomorrow. Sally, though, gave me an icebreaker. So if you wonder why I have candy in my mouth, that's the problem. I got an icebreaker. It'll be gone in a second. So great to be here. I hope you're excited. I'm excited because my voice is up here. That's why. If it was down low and I was relaxed, then I wouldn't be excited. To me, each and every week, not just Easter, this should be the place, not just this church, but a church should be the place we can't wait to be and we don't want to miss. So whether you go here or you go somewhere else, go somewhere. Because this is where God meets us. He speaks to us through his word, through his spirit, and I trust him for that. So I'm excited to be here this morning. One other thing from last week, I told you to vote on Tuesday, and I was wrong. It's this Tuesday. So if you already voted, good job. All right. We're going to stop and pray again. And this morning, as we look at Jesus' life, we're going to be asking the question, was it enough? Was it enough? What was what Jesus did in his birth, his life, his death, and his resurrection, was it enough? And not just was it enough for it to be scripture, but is it enough in your life as well? Will you pray with me? Dearly Father, I'm excited to be here. Again, I trust you for my voice, for the strength that I need. And I claim again your scripture that says when we're weak, that's when you're strong. And I believe in that with all my heart. Lord, you've proven that over and over again. You gave your life so that we could have life. And for that, we're grateful each and every day, but especially this morning, Lord. And so I thank you for the relationship that we can have with you, that we can talk with you anytime, that we can go straight to you and intercede on our own behalf, intercede on our family's behalf, intercede on others' behalf. And Lord, I just thank you for that relationship. Also, Lord, again, I thank you for the Holy Spirit that lives inside each person who's submitted their life to you, for the fact that as disciples, whether in the New Testament or today, your Spirit lives in us, guides us, empowers us to speak. I thank you for your word that through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, men wrote down these words so that today we can read them as well. We don't take that for granted, and we know there's many around the world, Lord, this morning that are persecuted for what they believe, that may even lose their life today for the fact that you gave your life. What an amazing privilege it is to know you, the creator of the universe. Again, we submit to you. I trust your spirit to speak to my heart and to speak to each heart that is here this morning. May you be honored and glorified, because I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, this morning, there are three phrases I'd like for you to think about as we begin. If you have your bulletin, you can look on the back of the bulletin, and you can kind of follow along where we're at. We're going to be in John chapter 20, verses 24 to 31. There's a Bible in your row if you'd like to. Not every Bible has John 20 on page 881, but in the blue Bibles in your row, we're on page 881. All right. God bless you. Now we're ready to go. Three phrases that I'd like to share with you this morning that have changed the world, that have changed the world. The first one is Jesus is born. The first one is Jesus is born. Christmas, right? Christmas, we celebrate Jesus is born. God became man. I heard somebody say, Jesus is God in a bod. I like that. God in a bod, coming to earth at Christmas. Second phrase is, it is finished. This was spoken by Jesus on the cross. We read that, we talked about that on Thursday night as we thought about Jesus coming to earth and dying on the cross. Sometimes it's on a weekly basis, sometimes it's monthly. We take communion, and communion is remembering that Jesus paid it all, that it was finished, and he paid it all. Nobody's perfect, right? We found that out last night, right? You watch the basketball game, nobody's perfect. We want perfection. We want perfection in a people, in teams, your children. You want perfection, but in the end, we're not perfect. We need a Savior. We need a Savior. Jesus paid it all. Communion is remembering that. And then thirdly, this morning, as we think about Easter, and as already has been read by the worship team, he's alive. He showed up to Peter, James, and John, to Mary Magdalene. He's alive. Over the last 4 months or so, in chapters 13, 14, 15, Jesus has been telling the disciples, I'm going to prepare a place for you. I got something else that's going on that you need to trust me for. I'm going to be leaving you. I'm going to die. And he's telling the disciples who have spent the last 3 years with him. And we've seen how Peter, Thomas, Philip, and then Judas, also known as Jude, they keep asking these questions. But why are you going to do this? How is that even possible? And before we look at John 20, just turn back a minute to John chapter 14. And there's three passages I want to read for you, because we see how patient Jesus is. We see how patient Jesus is. Look at John 14, verses 19 and 20. It says this, in John 14, verse 19, it says, before long, the world will not see me anymore, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. And on that day, you will realize that I am in my Father, and you are in me, and I am in you. He says, you might not realize it now, but on the day when I'm raised, when you see me again, you're going to believe. Then look at verses 28 and 29. You heard me say, I'm going away, and I'm coming back to you. If you loved me, you will be glad that I'm going to the Father, for the Father is greater than I. I have told you now before it happens, so that when it does happen, you will believe. I've told you now, so that when it happens later, you're going to know. You're going to know. Did they know? Did they believe? He's saying right now, you got a lot of different questions. But Jesus says, I'm telling you so that you will believe. The last one is chapter 16, and verses 30 and 32. Excuse me, verses 29 through 32. Then Jesus' disciples said, "Now you are speaking clearly and without figures of speech. Now we can see that you know all things, and that you do not even need to have anyone ask you questions. This makes us believe that you came from God." Verse 31, "Do you now believe?" Jesus replied. "A time is coming, and in fact has come, when you will be scattered, each to your own home. You will leave me all alone, yet I am not alone, for my Father is with me." The disciples say, "We believe, we get it, we get it." And what does Jesus say? "You believe now? Just wait." And what happened in the Garden of Gethsemane? The soldiers came, and the disciples ran. They scattered. It says here that Jesus was left alone. Did they believe? So I have one question for you. John chapter 20. I have one question for you. Is it enough? Is it enough? Verses 1 through 18. Peter, John, and Mary have been to the empty tomb. They've been to the empty tomb. The disciples were called by Jesus. They've seen him walk on water. They've seen the water turn to wine. They've been there where there was the feeding of the 5,000. They've seen demons called out. They've seen Lazarus raised from the dead. They've heard all the teachings. They've seen the baptisms. They were there for the triumphal entry. They partook in the Lord's Supper. But what's about to happen? What takes place in the beginning of, or excuse me, in the end of John 19, in the beginning of John 20, is something different than anything they'd planned. They expected Jesus to become the ruler. They expect Jesus to overthrow Rome. They expected Jesus to be the king of Israel. Now he's dead. It's not turning out as they had planned. Is Jesus' death and resurrection enough? Do they believe? Verse 19. On the evening of the first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jews. Excuse me, let me start over. On the evening of the first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. What were the disciples' response? They were overjoyed. They were overjoyed to see Jesus. And in verses 24 and 25, we get one disciple that wasn't there. One disciple, and we're not told why, but they weren't there. Look at verse 24. Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But Thomas said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails have been, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." Thomas was one of them that had asked questions before. And we're not told here, but I could almost see Thomas saying to Peter, "Peter, how can you say that you believe that Jesus came back to life? You denied him 3 times. Jude, Philip, Matthew, you guys all ran like I did. You're telling me he came back to life? No, unless I see it, unless I feel it, unless I touch it." Does he say that he doubts? We call him Doubting Thomas. Does he say that he doubts at the end of verse 25? No, he doesn't say that he doubts. He says, "I will not believe. I will not believe." What do you need in order to believe in Jesus? You need to touch him? See him? You need the miracles? We're not different than those disciples, are we? we continue to say, God, do this or else I won't believe. Do this or else. Why don't you ever show yourself to me? Verse 26. A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, peace be with you. By the way, this is just a little added bonus. If you ever walk through a wall and show up after you've died, the first thing you need to say is, peace be with you, okay? JL in his Sunday school class has talked about that. If you read something more than once, it means it's important. So you walk through a wall, show up, you need to say, peace be with you. And what does Jesus then say to Thomas, verse 27? Then Jesus said to Thomas, put your finger here, see my hands, reach out your hand and put it in my side. Stop doubting, stop unbelieving and believe. Stop unbelieving and believe. Jesus met Thomas where he was at and said, touch, see, and believe. Verse 28. This is all Thomas had to say. Thomas said to Jesus, my Lord and my God. There's no record here that Thomas touched Jesus' hands or put his hand in Jesus' side. There's no record of that. It says simply that when he saw Jesus, he believed. Jesus, throughout the book of John, we've seen him defeat sickness. We've seen him defeat evil. We've seen him defeat sorrow. We've seen him defeat death. And in verse 28, we see Jesus defeat unbelief. Unbelief. I appreciate the vulnerability of Thomas. Right? He's vulnerable, transparent. I don't believe. Sometimes we just go along with what everybody's been saying because that's what everybody's been saying. Have you done that? It's what my parents taught me. It's what my church used to teach me. What does the Bible teach? And do you believe it? Don't fake it. Jesus, you've heard me say this before. He's not calling us to be fakers. Do you believe it? David Guzik puts it this way. Thomas refused to say he understood when he didn't. He refused to pretend to believe when he didn't. But when he did believe, he said, my Lord and my God. He called Jesus Jehovah, Yahweh. What Jesus did was enough. And you know, it changed their lives forever. It changed the disciples' lives forever. If you look back at John chapter 15 and verse 18, Jesus says, if you follow after me, the world's going to hate you. The world's going to persecute you. They're not going to like what you have to say. As you read through the book of Acts, you see that they were stoned. They were persecuted for what they believed. In fact, except for John, every disciple was killed for what they believed. Now, if you lived with Jesus for 3 years and he said he was going to die and come back to life, and then we know that he died, would someone die if Jesus didn't really come back to life? Would you be willing to give your life if you didn't see Jesus again when he promised he was going to come back? These guys not only heard Jesus and saw Jesus, but they also said, he's alive. That's something worth dying for. That's something worth dying for. Jesus was enough for the disciples. But how about you? How about me? Is Jesus enough for us? Look at verse 30 and 31. Verse 30 and 31. Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you might believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have life in his name. I put this verse up here for you. Verse 30 says that John says, there's other stuff I could that I could have written down, but I didn't. Okay? There's many other things that Jesus did, but it's not all written down in the book of John. Verse 31, and I talked to my dad about this, so it's got to be right. It's kind of like Google. It's not wrong. Every other book of the Bible, right, following the Gospels, they're written to a church or a person, right? If you look at the book of Corinthians, it's written to the people, to the church in Corinth. If you read the other books of the Bible in the New Testament, they're written to somebody. The Gospels are not. We read them and we get to watch what's going on in Jesus' life. But here in this verse, it's like John's been telling us all this stuff is going on, and then he turns and he looks at you and says, this is why I wrote this down. I don't know that there's another verse like this in the Bible where Scripture has been, we're told about something, and then the writer turns to you and says, you know what? But I wrote these things down so that you would know, so that you would believe, and that so that when you believe, what does it say that we have? So that you can have life. He came to give us life. Jesus, through John, is speaking to you and saying, there's all this stuff that went on in the book of John. I could have written down more, but there's two things that I need you to know. There's two things that I want you to know. First, I want you to believe that Jesus is who he says he is. And second of all, you need to know that you can have eternal life. You can have eternal life. Study it. Look for it. See if you can find another verse like that in a setting like that. Jesus says, trust me. Trust me. Verse 29. Then Jesus told Thomas, because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet believed. God, why don't you appear to me? God, why don't you just do a miracle? Then I'll believe. The disciples had all those miracles. They had Jesus right there in front of them. And yet, until he came back to life, there was doubt. Jesus says to Thomas, and Jesus says to us, blessed are those who believe without ever having seen. Do you believe? Have you submitted your life to Christ? Jesus died so that you can have life. Jesus died so you'd have the opportunity to tell people in our community about him. There's a lot of people in Heston. And on Christmas and Easter, we have more people than ever show up at church. But there's a lot of people that are nowhere this morning. That makes me sad. Not because I want a big church, but because I want people to have life. It makes all the difference in the world when you have a hope and a future grounded in Jesus Christ. Are you willing to tell them about it? Are you willing? Or will we just keep showing up here and reading it over and over again? God's given you life. He calls you to give life to others in his Son, Jesus Christ. I'm going to invite the worship team to come up. You can come up right now. And the song we're going to sing is called Enough. I would just invite you that if you have questions, there's prayer teams that you can come and talk to. If you believe what you're singing, and we don't do this a lot, but if you believe what you're singing and you want to put your hands up, that means surrender, right? That means surrender. And I invite you to lift your hands if you want to and just, again, surrender your life to God and say, Lord, your death was enough. I believe in you. I trust you. How do you want to use me? Where do you want to use me? What do you want to do in and through my life?
Please stand and sing with us.